and a warm welcome to Big Picture. I'm Neelu Vyas. Education is the biggest measure of success and a qualitative indicator of the demographic dividend of any country. Have we been able to train and educate the people of our country to reap that dividend? What have been the immediate challenges in the education sector, and has the government of the day proved that it's serious on its motto of three E's, that is educate, enlighten and encourage? Joining me now are some of the most credible voices on the subject. TSR Subramanian, former cabinet secretary, somebody who has been in the news for the new education policy. Professor Saumen, Chattopadhyay, chairperson, Zakir, Husain, Center for Educational Research. Tom Vadakkan, the spokesperson from Congress. And also joining us is Mr. Rakesh, Sinha here. Welcome all of you on The Big Picture. I would like to start from you, Mr. Subramanian. Now that it's very clear that the draft education policy on which you worked upon, which was riddled with controversies for various reasons, now this report, or the committee rather, is going to be replaced by another one. What is the real indication according to you?
Well, I wouldn't like to comment on that because the committee's report was given to the government of India.
Right.
It is up to the government of India to decide how to take it further, what to do further with it. But I think you started with an important platitude, which means a platitude that education is the measure of success and qualitative indicator of a democracy. I don't think a single Indian believes it. You may say this is a statement that you have made just now. The reason I'm saying it is that only last week, you may or may not see it credible, there is the Pew Foundation from US,
right.
Templeton Foundation. Its report has just come out now, last week, 10 days back. Inter-country comparison of 190 countries. You won't believe it. India comes dead last. Dead last it comes. It also says inter alia that Indians in America are the highest in America, highest than the Jews, who are the highest group in the world.
Mm-hmm.
This is in terms of educational achievement. In terms of educational quality, we have ASAR report. We have the NAC of the NCERT. And then we used to have PISA, which we have discarded because we don't like bad message in India. We shoot the messenger. We don't want you to come and tell us what's happening in India. This ASAR now talks of, after 8 years of schooling, 50% of children cannot handle material of class 2.
Right.
After 8 years of schooling, 50% of people do not have the basics of arithmetic. And even more crushing, this is on quality. The Pew report is on total educational achievement.
Right.
This is on quality. After the last comment is that the latest government CERT sample surveys now say that in between 2012 and 2014, there is a decline, sharp 50% decline in reading and arithmetic levels. Just come out
but
now.
That,
last 50.
That clearly points out.
No, wait a minute. All I want to say is this here. This is on quality. Thirdly, we have probably the worst data in the world. I've gone into detail, but I'm going to here.
Right.
So I think that we are now, nobody serious now. I think that we should now revise it now. We will say that education is not very important, which is the reality of the country. You asked me a question. I told you what. Final question is, I frankly think that the government thinks that it can do band-aid solution.
Right.
It thinks that everything is fairly all right. We are doing very well. We are sending still people to Harvard and Princeton. And therefore, nothing needs to be done. We have to fool a few politicians. We've got to fool the higher education sector. We've got to make sure that all the capitation fee systems continue. We have a regressive policy at primary education. We keep politics here. This is untold story, and that remains. And therefore, I have now come to the conclusion: it doesn't matter a damn, because in my lifetime, I'm not going to see change.
Before I go to Mr. Sinha, I'd like to take quick comments from Mr. Vadakkan and then Mr. Chattopadhyay. Congress has been in power for the last 10 years. I mean, almost a decade. What was the main reason why the real issues, as what Mr. Subramanian has said, the real issues have not been highlighted? We haven't gone to the basics of education, the real problem.
See, it's a reality today that there are huge problems in the educational sector. There are a few things that, as Mr. Subramanian mentioned, don't change, because there's a lot of vested interest in this whole game.
Okay.
The educational sector has become riddled with this vested interest, whether it is the schools, whether it is the colleges, higher education sector, medical colleges. Now, if you take up the capitation fees he mentioned, I'm just mentioning a few. There's a huge people linked with politics, be it my party, be it the BJP, be it the left, be it the right. Political integration right. is there complete. Now, there's a lot of financial implication. The infrastructure has been laid, not to the satisfaction of probably an international standard, but yes, a movement has been made. That initial efforts were made. Now, quality infrastructure is something that is wanting. It's in a huge country. You can't compare Britain with Indian system of education. Right. But then we take Britain, US as role models. I can tell you something, that when you work up the syllabi of the university, there's almost a copy-paste operation that goes on.
Right.
I've been associated with Delhi University as a student, as a chairman of about for almost a decade. And I know the system operates. You want a new course, you have to go through the rigmarole. You can't introduce a new course because A, the industry has to be associated with application of the number of students that
would
come in.
But I'd like to interrupt you here. The moment the industry comes in, and again, I would like to link it with the vested interest. Mr. Chattopadhyay, is it really easy when the industry also comes in to, you know, wipe away these elements of vested interest? And then obviously politics also creeps into it. How can you really move out of this hawkish system?
Before I deal with the industry question, but let me share my understanding. I think India is an example where education has failed. I mean,
okay.
The social disorder and the economic disorder are merely the manifestations of and failure in the realm of education.
Mm-hmm.
And why it is so daunting a challenge for the government? Because the process is very important, where we produce quality research right. and the teaching learning outcome. The process has been subverted both in the public sector as well as in the private sector for okay. two different reasons.
Okay.
Private sector is purely commercialization, which are actually inimical to the goals of education that you actually began with. And in the public sector, the subversion may not lead to any money gain of the stakeholders, but it is the malpractices which are actually at the root causes. So unless we reflect and take care of the market, see, if there were technology, if the market could have been solution, we would have been able to produce good quality education the right. way it has ushered in revolution in the IT market, the cell phone market, the fridge market. Why in education we have failed?
Right.
And therefore, the role of education has to be understood in the broader context. Industry will cater to the need of the market. They are profit oriented. At the same time, some of the sectors would be interested in catering to the needs of the society.
Okay. Now,
so there could be a conflict of interest between education and industry.
Okay, now let me get in Mr. Rakesh Sinha here. Mr. Sinha, are we really making the right noises as far as the quality of education is concerned, the vested interests and the quality of education, as I just spoke about? Has the government really not missed the woods? Because what we are getting to hear and why education makes news is because of things like saffronization, unrest on campus, all what we have seen over the last 1 year. At least the noise has not been made in the right direction.
Before coming to that, I would use three terms. There are challenges, there are opportunities, there are also achievements. I won't share the pessimism. The way people are presenting that we are completely failed. We are not failed. Indians are dominating Silicon Valley. The Indian educated people are dominating all over the world. We are in demand. Engineers, doctors, and in multinational companies. So I don't say that Indian education has completely failed. Yes, there are challenges and there are also opportunities. I am talking about two things. Look, Indian, as far as social science, there are two categories. One is technical, the other is social science. Indian social science has not been decolonized. I agree. This is a copycat of the Western social science. We are following the paradigm of the Western countries.
Right.
So Indian social science needs to be liberated from the Western impact influence. There should be exchange of ideas.
Right.
But Indian context, Indian situation should be in the social science. Look, Kautilya's Arthashastra is highly ignored and neglected. You are not teaching your own philosophy. You are not teaching the Western binary is dominating our social science. That is not saffronization. And as far as saffronization is concerned, if you are changing Guru Tegh Bahadur is considered in NCERT book is written as a rapine, then you have to change it. If Bhagat Singh is a terrorist, then you have to change it. If such changes are saffronization, then saffronization should be welcomed by each and every Indian citizen. As far as changes are concerned, I am bothered about the primary and higher, primary and secondary education. The quality of education is more abysmal stage at this level. And you see, in the UPA regime, there was a trial and error about the 10th examination.
Mm-hmm.
Students were not clear about whether they have to appear in the examination, not to appear in the examination. All the whims and wishes of the ministers and his core group, which and I think during the 10 years of UPA regime, it was a vested interest to be dominated. Now changes are taking place.
Mr.
I welcome the changes that there should be examination at the 10th level.
Let me complete.
2 crore 75 lakhs 2 crore 75 lakhs students appear in 10th examination. Only 20 lakhs students don't appear in the examination. So out of 2 crore 75 lakhs, 20 lakhs don't appear. So you are considering 20 lakhs, you are not considering rest 2 crore 50 lakhs students. So I think it is a welcome decision by the government to reinitiate the 10th class examination. There should be examination at the lower level.
Mr. Sinha, there has been a perception that both BJP and the Congress haven't been very different in their approach as far as education is concerned. Let Mr. Vadakkan respond to what you just said.
I differ with my friend on this issue, because I think there's a case of short memory. You must have heard headlines at that time how many 10th standard students were not ready for the exam. There were many cases of suicide, stress-related problems. The feeling was that before they go into that phase, let us remove that stressful level, because those days it was not a question of vested interest that 10th standard was removed. We had to evaluate public perception and the creation of stress that the children had to go through. It was in that context it was done. There was no question of vested interest per se in that. Now, when it's bought back...
I don't agree. No,
the stress level was extraordinary.
Let me complete 2 more points.
Yes, Mr. Sinha, go ahead.
The teacher, you just see, the last two and three decades, the teacher's training has been completely surrendered to the private hands. And the fake universities, fake institutions are giving the teacher a BA degree, and those teachers are coming to the schools, they are teaching the students. How can you expect the quality education? I think the government is moving in the right direction. For the first time, BA education is now the complete control of the government. Government schools are going to be given primacy, and the private institutions, fake institutions, are no longer in this field. One more change that should be welcomed, that is learning output. It should be part of the rule book. It should not be a subjective matter. It is an objective thing. How much students are learning and getting skills in class 1, class 2, class 3, it should be made the part of the rule book.
Right.
I think, as far as I know, Mr. Javadkar is moving in that direction. And last 10 years, means during the UPA regime, there was nothing on the learning output. No effort was made by the government. They were only interested the private universities should come in India, they should open their campus. So here,
but Mr. Sinha, is it not true that even your government's major emphasis is to bring in private investors in education? I'd like to get in Mr. Subramanian here. Do you really agree with what Mr. Vadakkan and Mr. Sinha have just spoken? Are the two parties almost not the same with their approach in education, as far as the quality of education is concerned, training of teachers is concerned? Are they really addressing these issues?
See, this is now a national phenomenon, that there is no, if one party says it is day, the other will say it's night. We all know. I don't think we should now worry about it now.
Mm-hmm.
I think we are now digressing from the first sentence of your debate.
Right.
You're coming into details right now.
Right.
Class time is extremely important. No detention is extremely important. Educational outcome is extremely important. There are 250 such things are extremely important. each one deserves a 10-hour discussion.
Right.
I thought the focus of this here is, I think Ms. Rakesh Sinha rightly said, that yes, this is what the Pew report recognizes. It says the highest, he also referred to, don't compare with other developed countries. I am now comparing with Malaysia. I am now comparing with Rwanda. India, the only group of countries in the last 10 years, India is sub-Saharan Africa, and their rate of growth is higher than in India. I think we are now totally, wood for the trees. Immediately, the quality of the debate descends into minuscule particulars. Each one is extremely important. But the issue is, I don't think either the opposition nor the government really is worried about the quality of education. They're really worried about improving the state of education here. They're really convinced that PM is convinced that black money has to go. Important steps are being taken. I don't see that kind of urge to see education. Even now the theory is everything is fine. You said the number one thing in a country, do you think anybody agrees with this country? So I am not sanguine at all. I think that this debate gets trivialized at the slightest opportunity to descend into detail. And we always forget, do we need fundamental reforms? One, which are the five fundamental reforms? Number two, do we have the political will to do that? Number three, can we handle the politics of this? Number four,
right,
will the government go through? Has somebody said that? Somebody proceeding, I think that for me, that's the issue.
But all these factors which you have just pointed out, the structural reforms and the basics of education, the quality of education, how you strengthen the quality of education, all these things get reduced when you get into the politics of it. Mr. Vadakkan, I would like to get in a comment from you here, that why is it that education, why can't education be out of this political purview? And why cannot it go in the hands of educationists who have handled it seriously? Because the moment you give it to the politicians to decide on the policies, it merely is reduced as a political tool.
I agree completely with you. There has to be a fundamental change. Now today...
But when you say a fundamental change, what kind of a change are you really hinting at?
I'll tell you what.
Can we come out with some suggestions
in
this show?
Yes. I think the Ministry of Education should be headed by people who are part of an educational system.
Okay.
Who understands the basics.
Right.
Now, one example I'll point out. The governor of a state appoints the vice chancellor.
Right.
I'm not so much worried about the qualification of the governor. Maybe he is intellectually capable of selecting people.
Mm-hmm.
Then the issue comes, he selects people who are connected with his connectivity with whichever political ideology he believes in.
Right, right.
Now you have people as vice chancellors there. Now all this need to be removed from the purview of politicians.
Right.
I accept it.
Right.
I mean, this is a fundamental change, which if this government talks about surgical operation,
right,
why don't you do that?
But let
us see that change.
Right. Let me get in Mr. Sinha on this. Just about 10 days ago or 15 days ago, Mr. Javrekar had said that, you know, he's going to replace the Subramanian committee with another committee, and, you know, probably another report will come out. And he also said at the same time that the person heading that new committee will be an educationist. Now, can I know from you that what exactly is the definition of the new educationist? What is this? What is that educationist going to do, which probably a person like Mr. Subramanian could not do?
No, that is a prerogative of the government that I can't comment on that. But I can say that just Vadakkan, Tom Vadakkan said that educationists should head the education ministry. Then when you are forming a committee for the reform in the education, it should be naturally headed by those people who are engaged in the who have been engaged in the education field of education. Education should be liberated from the hands of the bureaucracy also. During the Congress regime, the bureaucracy dominated the sector of education. Now, that is one of the reasons that everything has been remained unchanged. They moved everything in a very traditional manner, in a status quo manner. So I agree with Mr. Subramanian. There should be a fundamental change.
Is the BJP also not getting?
Be in air. I'm giving one example. I'm giving one example. This government has formed addressed the question of language. Professor Kapil Kapoor, former Pro Vice Chancellor of Jawaharlal Nehru University, headed a 17 members language committee, and he has submitted a report.
But Mr. Sinha,
Government is moving in the right direction.
Mr. Sinha, if you say that Congress had been maintaining a status quo, how is BJP different? Because we see that BJP also hasn't maintained the autonomy of the institutes. You have RSS people coming and joining in as, for example, this National Book Trust Chairman, Baldev Sharma. He was a former editor of the RSS mouthpiece, Panchajanya. So basically, you have gotten people who are close to your party's ideology, and you have ensured that your ideology drives the agenda, the educational agenda. So how can you expect justice, and how can you really expect that the quality of education, the basic need of the country, which the country is clamoring for, will be addressed? How do you ensure that?
No, if Prabhat Patnaik and K.M. Panikkar are appointed, then you don't raise the question that a Marxist is dominating.
Right.
If Baldev Sharma is appointed, then you question the RSS is appointed. RSS is a part of the civil society.
But sir, what about
if
people?
If someone is a member of RSS, that is not a disqualification.
Mr. Sinha, over the last 1 year, Mr.
If
Sinha,
if anything wrong Baldev Sharma is doing, then you
Mr.
can
Sinha,
raise the
Sinha,
question.
Mr. Sinha, over the last 1 year, we have seen.
I am surprised. In the Indian Council of Historical Research was headed by all the time Marxist. Then nobody has raised the question. Marxists are learned people. Marxists are the part of mainstream. RSS is not the part of mainstream. This is the presumption of the all the debates. I'm sorry. RSS is a part and parcel of the civil society. As a Marxist has right, so RSS person has right, so a Congress person has right. Don't discriminate on the basis of ideology. See the qualification of the person, performance of the person. A person should be judged by his performance, not by his ideological inclination.
Okay, let me get in Mr. Subramanian. He has to say something. Yes, sir.
Well, I'm not in the defense of this. I know that apart from the political class, the most maligned class in India is the bureaucracy. Clearly, the bureaucracy doesn't know anything at all. And I think this government has made a huge blunder in having a committee headed by the bureaucracy.
Right.
That they cannot escape that. I think the issue is different now. And again, we are coming back to the details again. For me, the issue is different now. We have now given 100 plus concrete suggestions. 1, 2, 3,
right.
4, 5, 6. How to dethrone the minister and the bureaucrat and the director, bring the teacher and the student and the school in the focus number one.
Right.
Or 3, 4, 5. How to change the data system. How to use technology. You can spend the next 20 years debating it. Nothing is going to happen. Yes, I think I think these are labels. Like doctors, I don't need one doctor who can solve all problems of the body. And there are 300 areas in education. Anybody says he's an educationist who knows more than 5 of those 300, I know he's a fraud. He's a fraud. No,
right.
No, one luck. I would only suggest, please have 5 high-quality educations.
Okay.
Let them look at these 100 suggestions. And in 100 days, and say, yes, no, modified. I say yes.
But
so it doesn't matter who gets the suggestions and how. I don't know, people are important now. Let it in 3 months' time, each one, we agree, disagree, discard, improve within 3 months.
But
you do that.
But Mr. Chattopadhyay, knowing the fact the way the present government has functioned and also the earlier UPA government has functioned, especially with this government over the last 1 year, we have seen, you know, the education sector has been riddled with news stories about the functional autonomy of the institutes like IITs and IIMs being cut with the IIM amendment bill. Then you have the campus unrest. These kind of stories have been coming out. But as what we just discussed in the beginning, the basic needs of the education sector have not been catered either by the BJP or by the Congress. What is the way forward, especially when you know that the bureaucracy is divided, the political class is divided and driven majorly by its ideologies, whether it's the right or the left? How do you really embolden the education sector with reforms then?
See, the policy making would never be devoid of politics, because every political party has got a mandate.
Right.
And education is an instrument for self-transformation, which will eventually lead to societal transformation and cater to the needs. So the politics will continue to, if I may use the bad word, interfere, right? But what is the way out? First, I think the resources. You know, both at all three levels, I think we need to pump in
when
more
resources. When you say resources, the budget, the budgetary allocations have been cut.
The problem. I mean, if you look at the diagnosis of the problem, I have read the draft of the education policy. The diagnosis part is quite transparent and honest.
Right.
It's a question of implementation. Right. So the resources have to be pumped in. 40% of the teaching posts are lying vacant, right, as the report rightly suggested. Right. It's true for the school education level. We don't have quality teachers. Second is the governance part. We do how to convert the resources to meaningful outcome is the governance. Now, when it comes to the governance, the autonomy is supreme. You know, there's a hallmark of higher education would be academic autonomy.
Right.
But autonomy should be extended
right,
with accountability.
Right.
So there are some mechanisms of accountability.
Okay.
But I think the autonomy part has to be respected, has to be given.
Autonomy has to be respected.
Respected has to be given. And then
right,
you enforce accountability mechanism.
Right.
There are various ways.
Right. Oh, are we really running short of time? Quick comments as to what is the way forward to really freshen up the education sector?
I still maintain political interference into universities, colleges must end.
Okay.
Dalits have died, whoever has died, investigation is not how he died, who are the people responsible for it.
Right.
But the question is whether he's a Dalit or not.
Right.
The point is unless political interference stops,
okay,
so let there be a very big full stop. Let
okay,
educationists
so a full stop,
manage education.
A full stop to political interference. Mr. Subramanian, what's your prescription?
In 10 seconds, I would say that 70 years after independence, it was heartening to note, well or ill implemented, government now knows that the parallel economy must go. You may agree, disagree with the
right,
details,
right,
et cetera, et cetera. We agree. That consensus has to come.
Right.
I not at lower levels, at the PM level, number one. Political system has to be cleaned up. Education has to be cleaned up. Public health has to be cleaned up.
Right.
These are the only things to be done. Government need not do anything more.
Okay.
The whole country will change in 10 years.
Okay. Mr. Sinha, you've already heard the prescription which Mr. Subramanian has given. What do you have to really say? What's the way forward?
No, I think that for the last seven decades, the Congress during the Congress rule, it was the political intervention which led the decline of the institutions in India and the failure of the education policy. They formed committee one committee after another committee, but the output is zero. I think there is a need for fundamental change that I agree with Mr. Subramanian, and that change should come at the micro level.
One okay,
most important thing is to expansion of education in the rural area with a quality infrastructure. That should be priority of any state government as well as central government. We have a cooperative federalism, so responsibility lies on both.
Okay.
Second important thing is that you have to see the research level. At the higher level, the research outputs in India is low, far lower than the research output in developed countries, even in comparison to some developing countries. So we have to concentrate on higher education, and we have to differentiate between the mass education and super specialization.
But how? But how BJP
not,
government?
Super specialization should be confined to those who are really concerned to the research.
But how BJP government is going to do, in fact, all eyes would be exactly on that. But remember, by 2030, a survey says that about 140 million students will be going in for higher education. So certainly there is a need of a series of structural reforms, which any the government, be it BJP or Congress, they really have to respect following that. Thanks to all my guests, Mr. Chattopadhyay, Tom Vadakkan, Mr. Subramanian, and also a very big thank you to Mr. Rakesh Sinha. Goodbye and thanks for watching.